Well, what worries me most is the social and political reaction to climate change.
Hey, it's Mike Hill, and you're watching Futurist World, your home for ideas about the future and how to shape it. Get ready to pitch yourself into the world of tomorrow, because today we're sitting down with San Francisco Bay Area futurist, author, and speaker Jamais Cascio on the future of society. We connected with Jamais at the Institute for the Future in Silicon Valley, California, where he's a research fellow. Jamais Cascio is a University of California graduate and is a contributor to the Atlantic Monthly and the Wall Street Journal. And he's also authored 4 books, including Hacking the Earth, Understanding the Consequences of Geoengineering. Jamais is ranked by Foreign Policy magazine as one of the top 100 global thinkers and is described by Dr. Michio Kaku as a leading futurist with a long career of thoughtfully contemplating the outlines of tomorrow. He travels the world speaking about future possibilities, including at TED Talks and the National Academy of Sciences. So get ready to get social and ponder what the world of tomorrow has in store for us. And remember, if you prefer an extended podcast, please subscribe at Futurist World. Jamais, great to have you here today.
Glad to be here.
All right. So today we're talking about the future of society. But before
just a small topic.
Just a little topic, yeah. But before we get into that, I want to ask you about futurism. What is a futurist?
Futurist is someone who has a professional interest, a desire to understand why the future will occur the way it will, to understand what possible futures we have in front of us, and to help think through what might we do to steer towards the futures we want and away from the ones we don't want.
Why is this important? Why do we need to, you know, what benefit does society get out of thinking about the future?
Well, do you think there's a benefit to be able to look ahead on the road while you're driving? I mean, driving with a blindfold on is a little difficult. And that's essentially what a futurist does. We help our society look ahead and see what different possibilities are in order to make better decisions now. From my point of view, the role of a futurist isn't to tell someone what will happen. It's to essentially create moments of epiphany, you know, those aha, I never saw it that way before, to help organizations, to help people, help leaders see different possible consequences that they wouldn't have otherwise thought about before.
So we're talking about the future of society today. When you think about the current trends in the world, what are some of the greatest challenges? What worries you most?
Well, what worries me most is the social and political reaction to climate change. The challenge of climate change is that it is a lag-based system. That is, the actions that you take, the material that you put into the atmosphere, won't actually have an effect, a measurable effect, for decades. So the warming effects that we're seeing now are really based on carbon that was put into the atmosphere in the 1970s. That also means we could stop putting any additional carbon into the atmosphere now, right this very second, and it would continue to warm for another couple of decades. So think about that not as a scientific issue, but as a political issue. You've asked people around the world to change their lifestyles, in some cases pretty dramatically, and you're not getting any benefit. The world is still getting warm. There will be people who will say, the Exxon and the right-wing people were right. This is all a big hoax just to get us to become socialists or whatever. You know, there'll be people who say the scientists were lying to us the whole time. And that's not the case. That's not true. But what is true is that there will be a lag between doing the right thing and getting the right results. And that's going to be politically extraordinarily difficult to handle around the world.
So, you know, carrying on along that path, when we flip the script, what gives you hope today, looking at current trends for what may happen in the future?
What gives me hope today are people born after the year 2000, young people. And that's just not just because I'm a crotchety old man. My hope is driven by the idea that you have these people who have tools and processes that they know how to use, that they've grown up with, that will allow them to make changes in ways that those of us who are old won't even recognize until they've hit us. That's what's been so fascinating about the anti-gun movement that's emerged recently in the United States, driven by younger people, is that it's been organized not by the conventional sending out flyers and let's find a leader who will tell us what to do. It's been organized by this kind of asymmetric network of sharing.
Yeah, and more power to them. Yeah. So, I mean, we're here in Silicon Valley, so let's just touch on technology and society. Sure. Things like, once we get quantum computing happening.
The thing about quantum computing in particular, the basis of all of our encryption is factoring. That is, you know, figuring out what numbers you multiply together to get another number.
Right.
And right now, that takes the life of the universe with your conventional computers, or with computers 10 years from now, it'll take centuries. But with a quantum computer, in principle, you could bring that down to a matter of minutes. And so suddenly, if quantum computing takes off, every encryption system that we have, that banks use, that the government uses, or governments use, that individuals use to keep their phones private, all of that goes away.
This is like the Millennium Bug all over again, you know, like the sky's falling.
And that's actually a really interesting parallel. And I want to take that, you know, talk about that for a second, because a lot of people think about the Y2K, the Millennium Bug, as being, oh, that was no big deal. No, it was just, you know, people talking a lot about something and there was nothing. Well, you know why it was nothing? Because you had people working day and night for the years leading up to the year 2000 to fix the problems that were going to happen. It was, they basically saw that it was an imminent disaster, and they acted. And they fixed it before it became a catastrophe. And as a result, we all say, it must not have been real because it didn't happen. Well, no, it was real, and we stopped it.
All of this surveillance technology that hangs around our society now, it really seems to have eroded our autonomy, our individual autonomy to some extent. Is that something we should be worried about?
Well, my default answer is always, we should be worried. Regardless, we should be worried. When it comes to surveillance, this is actually kind of a weird moment. We're also developing technology, a lot of it based on machine learning, that will allow us to modify video and essentially use Photoshop on videos to make it look like this is someone doing something they didn't do.
Fake news.
You know, faking it. So whether we're talking, there's a system called deepfakes, which has been used to make porn movies of famous celebrities.
Right.
But this kind of thing could be used for political purposes, for economic purposes, for blackmail, extortion. The way you push back against that is to have lots and lots of cameras, personal and institutional, showing what people are doing so that, no, there's just one video of me doing that, but there are 14, 27, 300 videos of me from that same time doing something completely different.
Right. Most of that was.
And so that in that kind of scenario, surveillance becomes self-defense as well.
Is privacy an outdated concept?
No, but we need to be really clear on what privacy is. Privacy, from my perspective, is the ability to decide who gets to see things about you. So everyone will say, well, we want our credit card numbers to be private. Well, you don't want them to be secret, where nobody knows, because you want the department store, you want Amazon or whomever to know what your credit card number is so you can engage in that transaction. Privacy is controlling who gets to see. Mm-hmm. And I suspect that that will be the direction of regulation, that not trying to stop people from taking pictures, not trying to stop surveillance cameras or whatever, but to give the people who are the subject of that surveillance more control over what gets done with that information.
I want to talk about sci-fi for a minute, because sure. I love sci-fi. Are you inspired by any sci-fi movies, books, TV, novels? You know, like, what is it, you know, that really resonates with you when you think sci-fi?
Well, there's a comic book series called Transmetropolitan. You know, imagine a science fiction version of Hunter S. Thompson, you know, the gonzo journalist. It is profane and vulgar and
awesome. Surprising,
and to my mind, still one of the best representations of what the future will feel like. So Transmetropolitan, to me, especially since it has as its core story a journalist bringing down a corrupt president.
Right, okay.
Yeah, can't resist that.
Love it, okay. So just to wrap it up, when we're thinking about the future of society, where are you at? Optimistic, pessimistic, where are we going?
I'm a short-term pessimist, long-term optimist. Mm-hmm. Things are going to get worse before they get better. But if we live through it, we have so much potential to make as close to a utopia as you want to imagine. We know what to do to solve the problems that we face. The question isn't figuring out the answer. The question is implementing the answer and being willing to make the changes in our lives, knowing that we won't see the benefit immediately. That future is possible. That optimistic, almost utopian future is very possible. We know how to make it. We just need to make that decision.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
And that's a wrap on the future of society with Jamais Cascio. But before you go, I need your help with something. The purpose of this series is to move humanity forward and help us shape a better society for our kids. So we'd love to know what made the biggest impression on you from today's conversation. Was it the discussion about futurism, planning for digital security in the age of quantum computing, or what privacy means to you? The best conversations happen right now, so please get involved and leave a comment below. Another great place to join the conversation and find more thoughtful content is at Futurist.world. And when you're there, be sure to sign up for access to exclusive content and awesome giveaways, including Jamais' book, Hacking the Earth. You can find us on all the usual social platforms via the links below. And thanks again for joining us. The future is out there. See you next time on Futurist World.